You're listening to Pedia Pain Focus, episode number 22, and I'm your host, Dr. Anjana Kundu. Today, we discuss all things melatonin, its role for sleep regulation, controversies around its use, and in particular, whether to use this for children. So stay tuned.
Pedia Pain Focus.
You're listening to Pedia Pain Focus, brought to you by Proactive Pain Solutions. Pedia Pain Focus highlights pediatric pain information and provides tools and resources for all healthcare professionals taking care of children dealing with pain. Here's your host, Dr. Anjana Kundu.
Hi there, and thank you for joining me for this episode of Pedia Pain Focus. You know, we're living through some incredibly unusual times, to say the least. First, the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic, and now these protests fueled by racism and inequality issues. My husband says that year 2020, in his book, has been a dumpster fire so far. The widespread impact that these events have extends way beyond the morbidity and mortality risk from COVID-19. The socioeconomic devastation, the impact on mental health and stress levels have also been massive. And amongst other things, these events have put people's vulnerabilities, emotions, and their distress on a big display. People are experiencing sleep disturbances, partly because of the stress levels and also in part from the changes in our routines that we've seen because of this disruption. Discussions in some of the forums that I belong to and also with our friends and family have brought up some questions around sleep and around the use of melatonin to help the sleep. And that is what really inspired me to address this issue more broadly. I thought if so many people are talking about it, we should certainly be discussing this around our patients' use and even personal for that matter too. Sleep issues tend to be a big problem with my patients, all the pediatric pain patients. And as healthcare professionals, you know that pain and sleep are very integrally related. Pain disrupts sleep, and poor sleep has adverse effects on pain, resulting in a vicious cycle. And addressing sleep issues is paramount for treatment of pain. We also know that many of the medications that we use for sleep typically have a lot of side effects, and some are even significant enough with the risk of addiction and abuse potential. So, enter melatonin. It is widely used for sleep regulation by millions of Americans, with or without prescription, with or without pain, because many believe that it's a natural and benign option. Melatonin has been called the most magical sleep supportive potion because it regulates the circadian rhythm, which is critical for healthy sleep. And it's even been compared to the Greek mythological goddess of the night, Nyx, who's the mother of Hypnos, the god of sleep. So melatonin has been referred to as the Nyx in a bottle. I mean, quite a status it has, right? No wonder its use is widely popular amongst both public and healthcare professionals. The global markets for melatonin in 2019 was estimated at $700 million, and that was up from $62 million in 2003. That's quite a growth. And that's not the end of it. It is projected to surpass over $2,000 million in 2025. And as of 2016, the top market share for melatonin sales was related to medical use, and estimated at 63%. So you see how popular it is? And in the public, it's used by all ages. A survey that was conducted by New York Times of about 1,000 parents of children under the age of 18 showed about one-third had a history of sleep difficulties, and half the parents reported giving melatonin to their children. And to be honest, even we have been giving it to our daughter even since she was a young kid, because often we end up traveling internationally, and mostly that's the time we end up giving it to her to help regulate her sleep. So with all this in the background, I thought it is timely that we have a discussion and take a closer look at melatonin, review what it is, what it's not, how it works, what does it do, and what it doesn't. and the evidence around when and how it can be used, whether or what problems its use may cause. So let's jump in. So first, what is melatonin? Where does it come from? Melatonin is a hormone that our bodies, particularly the pineal gland, produces. It is released in response to dark or low light, but inhibited during the day, and this regulates our sleep-wake cycle, which also now accounts for the variability of melatonin levels during a 24-hour cycle. Typically, serum melatonin levels in response to the dark, around, say, sunset, start increasing, and they reach the threshold which is adequate for onset of sleep in about 2 hours, so that's, say, 9 p.m. And these two events together are what help facilitate sleep. But the release of melatonin can actually be disrupted by artificial lights, especially the blue-white lights that we get from our electronic devices. The melatonin levels then continue to rise throughout the night until they reach a peak sometime during the third part of the sleep, the last third of the sleep, which is maybe around 1 to 4 a.m. And then these levels start to decline, with the lowest level corresponding to the daylight, and that's when they're low enough to cause us to wake up. So that's our normal circadian rhythm that is regulated by the release of melatonin from our pineal gland. And as a result of variation in serum melatonin levels, influenced by the pineal gland. In mammals, though, melatonin is also produced by extrapineal tissues. These are the mononuclear leukocytes, pancreatic islet cells, and the GI tract, amongst other things. And these amounts are actually larger than the amounts that are produced by the pineal gland. But these don't contribute to the circulating levels or the serum levels that we see, or even the levels that we see in the saliva that we test. And obviously, then they don't impact the circadian rhythm. Another thing is that mammals aren't the only producers of melatonin. It can come from a variety of sources. And the melatonin supplement, which is available on the market, is an artificially manufactured form of hormone that is present in plants or animals, bacteria, and fungi, other than human beings. Also, sleep isn't the only effect from melatonin. Owing to its antioxidant properties, melatonin finds applications in food and beverage industry, pharmaceuticals, and the dietary supplement industry. Melatonin is also used in the manufacturing of bio-based spray polyurethane foam, or what we call SPF, in the sunscreens. And now that I've started talking about the effects of melatonin, let's explore what it does. Melatonin plays a major role in many physiological processes and therapeutic functions, be it the circadian rhythm, our immune system, or clearing out of free radicals from our bodies. So let's take a look at them one by one. Number one, we said, and the most important, and the reason we're talking about it is regulation of sleep. I just reviewed how melatonin levels affect sleep and wakefulness depending upon the serum levels. And that's in a normal body, right? Although we think of circadian rhythm mainly as our body's internal clock that's responsible for the sleep and wakefulness, it's much more than that. The circadian rhythm is also basically the time when our bodies rest, repair, and clear out the byproducts, which happens at nighttime, so during the sleep cycle. And during the day, it generates or optimizes the performance and the functions of all our internal and external systems. The role of circadian rhythm in obesity and gut health has also become increasingly evident and a big area of research. But back to melatonin. Melatonin is important for the initiation and maintenance of sleep. It helps in two ways. One, it has sedative effects, which basically allows you to fall asleep. The increased blood melatonin levels help the onset of sleep by shortening the sleep latency and reducing the number of awakenings. But it doesn't necessarily impact the total sleep time. the direct sedative effects of melatonin are debated. And there is mixed evidence in that studies have also failed to show its benefit over placebos. But for the most part, we know that it allows us to sleep. So there comes in the second impact, which is through restoring circadian rhythm, which we kind of reviewed, but it is especially important in the cases where you need help with resetting the internal body clock to a different times and conditions, such as we see with jet lag. As I just mentioned, we give it to our daughter when we travel overseas. And also in situations where there is advanced or delayed sleep phase syndrome, like which happens in night shift workers or the shift workers, right? So these are the situations where it especially plays a role in regulating sleep. So what are the other effects? The other effects we earlier mentioned, like the antioxidant and free radical scavenger effects of melatonin. Now, there's a lot of literature to establish that melatonin and its metabolites function as endogenous free radical scavengers and broad-spectrum antioxidants. There's a relationship between the free radicals and oxidative stresses with aging and diseases like cancer, atherosclerosis, neurodegenerative disorders, diabetes, and inflammatory diseases, etc. And that has become increasingly clear with a lot more studies coming out. And this leads many to say that melatonin has even anti-cancer, anti-aging effects, etc. On top of that, we know that chronic pain is integral to many of these conditions. So melatonin may even help with some of those pain and sleep issues for pain conditions amongst these patients. Now, number three is its anti-inflammatory effects. Melatonin has shown physiologically anti-inflammatory properties. Studies have shown that melatonin reduces adhesion molecules and pro-inflammatory cytokines. It downregulates pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines, and thus it reduces the chronic and acute inflammation in many states. Number four is its effect in providing analgesia. I've kind of referred to it given its anti-inflammatory effects, antioxidant effects. But melatonin also has been given preoperatively to some patients, and they have shown reduced post-op opioid requirements. In another setting in the NICU for preterm and term neonates, there were decreased opioid and sedative requirements for the intubated patients. They even had lower pain scores after their paralysis had completely worn off, and this made the authors postulate that it had to be via its anti-inflammatory effects, perhaps. Number five is melatonin's effects on immune system. So it has immune-boosting effects. Melatonin enhances both the innate and cellular immunity. It stimulates the production of progenitor cells of the granulocytes and macrophages, and also of the NK cells. Number six, it has anti-apoptotic, neuroregenerative, and neuroprotective effects. Now, melatonin has been shown to provide mitochondrial protection, and it may indirectly prevent apoptosis. In the animals that had had their pineal body or the pineal gland excised, they demonstrated worse neurodegeneration after an experimental stroke was established in them. So this shows that somehow melatonin has some neuroprotective and anti-apoptotic effects. Number seven, it has been shown to have antihypertensive effects. The nighttime production of melatonin is found to be reduced in hypertensive individuals. And if you administer melatonin, it decreased blood pressure in several animal models. And then that was reproduced in humans, in healthy men and women, as well as in patients who actually had hypertension. So perhaps this is related to its antioxidant effects or the scavenging effects, which results in improved endothelial function, with increased availability of nitric oxide, which may have vasodilatory effects and reduces blood pressure that way. And number 8, now it is also being sold as an anti-aging product as well. As you can see, it's antioxidants, anti-inflammatory, it's used as an SPF. All these effects may lend itself to the claims that it's also anti-aging. Now, based on all these effects that we've reviewed, melatonin seems like not just this magical sleep potion, but a magical life potion. But you know what? Let's hit the brakes a little bit. Because the major sleep experts and guidelines from American Academy of Sleep Medicine, or the AASM, doesn't recommend it for the treatment of insomnia. I'm sure you're thinking, what? Why? Obviously, the millions of North Americans and people across the world seem to disagree with these guidelines too, just like you. You're also probably reflecting on your own patient population or even your personal use of melatonin and probably saying, come on, melatonin does help some people with sleep. What's the harm in trying it? We use all kinds of medication with high risk potential all the time and even for sleep issues. So why not melatonin? And moreover, patients can just get it without any prescription, so they don't even need us. So then why do medical experts hesitate to recommend this magical sleep potion to the patients? Why are there cautions around it? Here are some additional things to consider. These will help with your understanding about their hesitation, but also more importantly, they'll help you with your decision to help your patients understand all the important information around the use of melatonin so that they can make informed decisions about its use. So what are those? Number 1 are the uncertainties about product quality, dose, and timing. So most health professionals are hesitant to recommend melatonin supplements because of these uncertainties. So let's unpackage them one by one. Let's look at the quality issue first, which is definitely the biggest and a big one. Melatonin is unregulated and available over-the-counter in US and Canada, but it's available with prescription all over the rest of the world. And because it's not regulated by the US FDA, which, as you may recall from episode 21 about the off-label medication use, means that it does not undergo that rigorous process and evaluation of its safety and efficacy data. And because of that, the quality and content of melatonin is highly variable. Anyone can produce it, package it, and sell it. And available products on the market may contain anywhere from negative 83%, which is basically they have none, or negative 83% of the claimed value, to plus 478% of the labeled amount claimed. And they can have as much as 465% variation between the lots of the same product. So that's a huge variability, huge unpredictability. And only a handful of companies produce pharmaceutical grade or the pure melatonin that a consumer can get. So how does one know what to get and which one is good and which is not? Well, there's a resource there, consumerlab.com. It's a good resource for checking the accuracy of labeling, any adulterants that may be present in there, and even the safety and efficacy data, because they compile a lot of the literature. Consumerlab.com actually provides independent test results and information to help consumers and healthcare professionals identify the best quality health and nutrition products. So you can check any of those vitamins and supplements that are available over-the-counter products. So I would recommend that you check out this resource. The paid version is not expensive at all. I've actually had it for over a decade now, and they've been in existence for over 20 years. I'm not exactly sure how many, but definitely more than 2 decades. I personally got into this because of my use of integrative medicine therapies, and I typically use some of the supplements, so I wanted to be able to guide my patients accurately. So I definitely highly recommend this resource if you ever use any of those, or I'm sure your patients ask about it, so you can even guide them to use this resource themselves if they so choose. Concern number two is that supplementary melatonin does not follow your natural circadian rhythm. So then it's really hard for experts to say with assurance that, yeah, if you take this, you'll get basically the same results. Now, naturally, melatonin levels are low early in the evening, but then they start to rise steadily through the night after sunset or after dark. And finally, peaks in the last third of the sleep, as we said earlier. Now, supplementary melatonin has a short half-life in contrast, and that's about 30 to 45 minutes. So therefore, taking a standard release, regular release tablet around bedtime would result in earlier peak tail, and which is precisely the opposite of the natural circadian rhythm or natural pattern that we observe. So that brings the question of the timing. So when should you take it if you want benefits from it? So when you're prescribing it for sleep for your patients, the best time is 20 to 60 minutes before the bedtime, and 60 minutes especially for the slow release one. The regular release, a little bit shorter time period, like closer to 20 to 30 minutes. And when you are prescribing it for restoration of circadian rhythm, or you're advising your patients to take it for jet lag or shift workers, then you should tell them to take it closer to their target bedtime. But the timing is also important. And taking time-release tablets at bedtime or sublingual release tablets in the middle of the night are more likely to produce the circadian rhythm that we know as compared to the regular melatonin tablets. Now, since we're talking about the timing, we also want to know how much to take, right? The amounts that are important to take to help regulate sleep. As I mentioned earlier, there's a big variability in the dose. I'll actually see some of my patients, pediatric patients, especially those with autism spectrum disorder or the ADHD patients, they're on dosages as high as 10 to 15 milligrams daily. What the literature, on the other hand, shows is that more is not better. A standard 3-milligram tablet is significantly more than what we need for sleep. And despite this, some products are marketed at dosages of 5, 10, and 15 milligrams. The studies have shown that this can actually be harmful to the natural circadian rhythm because it can downregulate our endogenous melatonin. Studies have also shown that daily dosages of 0.5 to 5 milligrams have similar effects regardless of the dose, although sleep onset may be quicker if the dose is higher. And there doesn't appear to be any significant advantage in taking more than the small dosages, definitely not more than 5 milligrams, especially if we're not combining this with sleep hygiene techniques like regulating the timing of your how late you eat or drink, turning off the electronics about an hour before, sleep environment regulations, other rituals that help somebody wind down from their day. So those are good sleep hygiene practices, and those remain important even more than taking the melatonin, which of course adds to the efficacy. Now, number three concern are the safety concerns. Melatonin generally has favorable safety profile. For the most part, it does not have any major adverse effects, though some short-lived fatigue and sluggishness, they're expected because that's how it works, right? I typically would recommend my patients to allow at least 6 hours of sleep time. I tell them to allow enough time before they're doing any complex tasks or operating any heavy machinery, which really isn't a big problem for pediatric patients. They shouldn't be operating any heavy machinery anyway, right? Now, that being said about melatonin safety profile, there are some things in the literature which create some controversies around the use of melatonin in certain specific patient populations. And that, my friends, requires a little bit of a discussion. So let's do that. So one is a controversy around its cardiac effects or the antihypertensive effects. Although earlier I said that melatonin may have antihypertensive effect, some literature out there does show adverse blood pressure and heart effects, in particular in patients with cardiovascular conditions who are taking antihypertensive medications. But what's unclear is whether that's because of melatonin per se or because of drug interactions. And what we haven't discussed is how melatonin is metabolized. It's metabolized by liver and by the cytochrome P450 enzyme pathway, which we know induces a lot of drug metabolisms. So it could very well be that that is why the antihypertensives aren't as effective, therefore causing that controversy of whether it actually has antihypertensive effects or not. Now, the other area where some controversy exists is around its immune effects, and particularly in its role in patients with autoimmune diseases. Melatonin's immune-enhancing properties has sparked a debate about the safety in patients with autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis. There was a study that linked raised endogenous melatonin levels in rheumatoid arthritis patients, and that convinced some of the clinicians that melatonin supplementation may not be advisable for these patients. However, there's even more evidence which suggests that melatonin may actually alleviate the symptoms of RA and even other autoimmune diseases. And that happens through its anti-inflammatory and antioxidant effects. Considering the tens of thousands of people who use melatonin daily, there have been very few indications about why it should be contraindicated for autoimmunity or for anything else for that matter, really. So go on and you would be okay to use it for your patients with rheumatoid arthritis or any other autoimmune disease. And finally, there's a concern about its safety in children. Of course, where would we be without discussion of use of anything in children on a pediatric podcast, right? So what are the concerns? One, its use in children is akin to off-label use. I know it's not regulated by FDA and not labeled, so technically, by that definition, it's not off-label. But honestly, it is a substance of unknown safety efficacy, so it's kind of off-label in that way. And there are also concerns about its impact on the developing or growing body of a child, which are unknown to some extent. And to top all that, there were some initial concerns raised around the premature puberty onset, and this was based on animal studies. There was an animal study that showed animals had onset of premature puberty. But subsequently, that hasn't borne out in humans. And there actually have been some large studies in children with up to 5 years of follow-up. And they found not only lack of evidence for this onset of premature puberty, but also really no other big adverse effects. So based on that, I think you can feel comfortable allowing its use in pediatric patients, as long as you take all these other discussions into consideration. So let's bring it all that together and see how we can put this in practice. Now, bottom line for melatonin is that it certainly helps with sleep regulation and that it also offers a variety of other beneficial effects, especially for the pain patients. We know that it is safe in pediatric patients based on some of these large studies with long-term follow-up up to 5 years. On top of that, we also know that it is widely available and utilized, and it is only going to increase based on the statistics that are available to us. We also know that your patients or their parents, in cases of pediatric patients, may not even ask for your input before they use it. In North America, whether you prescribe it or not, it's available over the counter to anyone that wants it. So it is important to understand how melatonin works so that you can counsel your patients appropriately in its use, and answer their questions if they have any. And since it's not regulated like the other medications, it's important to be aware that there's a wide variation in the quality and quantity of the available products on the market. It's worth looking into what companies offer pharmaceutical grade melatonin, which products are good, whether they're pharmaceutical grade or not. And as I said, consumerlab.com may help you with that. So there you have it. This information should allow you to help your patients make an informed decision about their melatonin use. Now, if you've enjoyed listening to this podcast or found this podcast helpful, which I really hope you did, please provide a review and leave me a comment. Your reviews and comments allow us and others to see this podcast and benefit from it. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to the podcast so that you will know immediately as soon as there's a new episode or a bonus episode that becomes available. I, in the meantime, will be back here in 2 weeks with another new episode. Until then, stay healthy and be proactive. Bye now. Pedia Pain Focus is brought to you by Proactive Pain Solutions, a company committed to improving the access, quality, and expertise in pediatric pain care. Through our online education and consultation for clinicians and institutions, we're transforming pediatric pain medicine. We're creating experts and leaders in the field and empowering patients and families with knowledge and tools for self-management to live a functional life. If you wish to advance your pain care expertise or improve the operational performance of your pain care services, please give us a call at www.proactivepainsolutions.com.